Are we ready? Let's get started. We would like to welcome everybody to the November 4th, 2013 Knightdale Town Council meeting. I can't believe I just said it was November. Time flies when you're having fun. We appreciate everybody being here tonight. We shouldn't have too long of an agenda. I know we have some Boy Scouts over here, and I promised I wouldn't keep them until 9 or 10 o'clock. But let's get started with the invocation from Councilor Tripp.
Let us pray. Father, we thank you for allowing us to come together tonight. We hope that you'll guide us in our decisions. And Father, we ask that you look over all our candidates running for town council tomorrow and guide the residents of Knightdale to make great decisions with their votes. And we appreciate you allowing us to serve you and serve the town of Knightdale. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. All right. Any changes to tonight's agenda?
No, sir.
Okay. Are any changes to tonight's agenda? Can we get a motion to adopt the agenda?
So move.
Second.
Have a motion and second. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Okay, we have minutes from the October 16th, 2013 meeting. Are there any changes, corrections, or questions about the minutes? If not, can we get a motion?
Make a motion to approve the October 16th minutes.
Second.
Have a motion and second to approve the October 16th meetings. All in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Motion carries as well. All right, next up is our proclamations, and tonight we have the Long-Term Care Awareness Month. I will read our proclamation quickly. Whereas the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services has reported that approximately 60% of individuals who are over the age of 65 will need some kind of long-term care services at some point, more than 40% of such individuals will require nursing home care. Whereas the GAO projects that by 2040, the number of individuals in the age group who are 85 years or older, which it finds the age group most likely to require long-term care services, is projected to increase more than 250% from 4.3 million individuals to 15.4 million individuals. Wow. Whereas an AARP study found that 59% of people in the United States who are 45 years of age or older overestimated the level of coverage under the Medicare program for nursing home care, and that half of such people who are 45 years of age or older indicate they believe such a program provides coverage for assisted living, which it does not. Whereas some 8 million Americans have purchased long-term care insurance protection for themselves and family members, including 400,000 in the most recent year, and whereas some $3.5 billion in insurance benefits are paid to over 180,000 Americans each year, whereas our town seeks to ensure that aging residents of Knightdale who will require long-term care are able to preserve their independence, ensure the right to receive quality care, and prevent placing considerable burdens on families, communities, businesses, or government programs. Now, therefore, I, Russell Killen, Mayor of Knightdale, North Carolina, on behalf of the town of Knightdale, do hereby proclaim the month of November 2013 as Long-Term Care Awareness Month, and urge all residents to use the opportunity to learn more about the potential risks, costs, and options available for themselves and family members for long-term care. All right. Next up is the public section of our meeting. This is the section that is open to anyone who would like to speak on an item tonight that is not already on our agenda. Is there anybody who would like to speak on an item that is not already on our agenda tonight?
Mr. Mayor, if I may, Nathan Ray, who owns World Karate Do, is running late tonight. He may be here to make his own presentation, but he had asked me to, he wanted to speak under the public section and would like our advice or direction on getting the name changed for the street that runs in front of his business there. I think it's Taekwondo Drive now.
Okay.
He would like to change that. I don't know if he has a recommendation or any suggestions, but I guess this would be appropriate to send it either to staff or to P&E.
Yeah, and if Mr. Ray gets here, we'll let him talk. But
okay.
I know I don't have any objection for renaming Taekwondo Drive.
I don't either.
P&E committee would love to look at that.
Okay, so
thank you, Councilman.
P&E will look at that, and we'll look at some name change options in light of how it ended up with the name Taekwondo Drive. I think it makes sense at this point to look at naming it something new.
Yeah. Thank you, sir.
I told Councilor Edens I would suggest bankruptcy court, but that probably isn't what we want to go with. All right. Anything else tonight on the public section of our meeting? All right. Next up is the consent agenda. Any comments or questions regarding tonight's consent agenda?
Make a motion to approve the consent agenda.
Second.
I have a motion and a second to approve the consent agenda. Any further discussions? All in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? That motion carries. All right. Now we get to the public hearings portion of our meeting, and first up is the Knightdale Station Amendment. How are you, Ms. Kern?
I'm doing well. I hope you all are tonight. Good evening, Mayor and members of Council. Before you tonight is the Knightdale Station UAA Amendment. Previously, this was known as the Myers Lake UAA. They proposed a subdivision name change request that was just approved. And they have submitted a UAA amendment to update some of the phasing schedule, including some rezoning dates, annexation dates, to actually coincide with what has occurred or what will occur, as well as consideration for council for a sign location at First and Knightdale Station Run. Staff, the town attorneys and the developers are still working through some of the comments we had on the initial draft. So before you tonight, we would recommend continuing the public hearing once we've received any input from the public to the next meeting, which is November 20th.
Okay.
And if you have any questions, I'm more than happy to answer them for you.
Any questions? Nope. All right. Is there anyone here tonight that would like to speak on this item, just to make sure? All right. In that case, we're going to continue it, so can we get a motion?
I'll make a motion to continue the public hearing to the November 20th, 2013 Town Council meeting.
Second.
Motion and second. All in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Motion carries. Okay. Next up, the amendment to the Town Code Section 8140 Livestock Ordinance.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, Council members.
You always get the good ones, don't you, Mr. Treisenberg?
I do. And I have so many for you tonight, too. Glad to be here on the 4th of November. Hopefully this will... Things are winding down now for the year. This first item that I have for you tonight takes off of the public hearing we had at the first meeting in October for the UDO amendment for suburban chickens. This would be an amendment to the town code that would be necessitated in order to make that UDO amendment possible, at least within the confines of the corporate limits. And chickens and domestic fowl and other animals fall under our livestock ordinance, which is section 81.40. And the changes are actually relatively simple. I can get this to work. Okay, thank you. So again, we've been over the justification that this is running in tandem with ZTA 7-13, which will follow shortly on the agenda. And the existing ordinance right now, the way it's written, there is just one chicken or domestic fowl that's allowed on a residential lot. The way it works right now is that you have to have at least 1 acre within the corporate limits to have any kind of horses or cows or anything that would fall under that definition of livestock and fowl. You can have as many as up to 4 for each additional acre of land that you have. So we would propose that in section B that we simply state an exemption at the beginning for female domestic chickens, and then following that in subsection D, here we would word that there would be no more than 5 domestic female chickens, and also make the reference to the UDO. Just very simply then, I did talk to Mr. York about this, and he gave his preliminary approval to it. This does not require that it goes back to the planning board or come back to you. So therefore, we would request action tonight in the form of an approval of TCA 113 and adoption of the ordinance, which is number one for you tonight.
Okay. And as Mr. Triesenberg said, this will be coming up again with our other amendment. Any questions about this? I understand P&E was happy with how this came out.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir. This doesn't affect the people that already have, and I see horses that's already got that we approved several years ago. But they've got horses and stables that are in the town limits.
And I think those
were exempt because they were grandfathered in because they were there before we did anything, correct?
And in some cases, those folks were able to actually get permits for the animals that they had.
Okay. All right.
Okay. All right. Any other questions for staff? Okay. Thank you. All right, this is a public hearing. If there's anyone here tonight that would like to comment on this item, please step up and state your name. Seeing no one. Any more questions or discussion from the council? If not, can we get a motion?
I'll make the motion to close the public hearing and adopt ordinance number 13-11-04-001.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? That motion carries. All right. So next up, tell you what, hold on, Jeff. Mr. Ray, we talked about you a minute ago, and come on up if you want to give us your spiel. We had a quick discussion on it. I don't want to hold you up all night to sit through the rest of our meeting unless you want to stay.
I was pretty excited about doing that, but that's okay. Thank you. Thank you all for allowing me just a moment to make a recommendation and a request. For some time, I've been here. I'm a native of Knightdale, and I've enjoyed seeing all the growth and the development that's taken place. Over near my place, World Karate Do, we're right here on the right around the corner from you all. I would like to request that you all would look into a more inviting name for the street that affronts Smithfield Road. There are two streets there that, in my estimation, if we could make it more inviting and more universal to suit those of us who've been there for a long time, as well as those who are coming into the new community that's abounding right next door to me in the new apartments. Changing the name and making it more universal in nature would do a few things. It would allow for everyone to be included with regards to what the names are on those streets over there. And it would be, there could be several names that we could use that would be inspiring. You know, the way that words work, they really penetrate the conscious and the subconscious. So names are very important. And we learned that in martial arts, and life out here is martial arts. So that's my humble request. I'll just keep it very simple. You know, you have Taekwondo Drive, you have Black Belt World Drive, but I think if we could come up with something that was universal for everyone, that would be something that would, for the future of that area and any other area for that matter, when we have names, that they be universal and applicable to everyone.
I think generally we agree with that. Our plan was centered planning and engineering. And if you have suggestions, you know, email them in. We'd love to hear it. Although Councilman Eden said that you had suggested Eden's Way was probably the best name for the street. But now that you showed up, we see that might not be entirely the case.
Well, Mr. Ray will not tell you this, but he is a native of Knightdale, graduate of East Wake High School, two-time world champion in karate. And he's been a great ambassador. He served on our planning board and very active in our Knightdale Chamber. And thank you for your support in this community, Master Ray. And
I had the misfortune of going to school with my sister.
Yes.
That too.
I would say the pleasure.
All right. No, and also, we're going to send that to planning engineering. If you have suggestions, email us, let us know, or you're welcome to show up for the meeting and participate in the discussion. But we think that is a good idea, and I appreciate you bringing it up.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you all very much.
Thanks, sir.
All right. Sorry, Mr. Triesenberg, didn't mean to bump you, but knew he wanted to. So now we are to ZTA 6-13, RVs and mobile home parks.
Yes. This, too, is a public hearing, and the case title is ZTA 613. This one was initiated by a citizen request through the Planning and Engineering Subcommittee. So it is a application that is asking for the addition for some allowances for RVs within mobile home parks, particularly those that are located appropriately in the manufactured home overlay district. The administrator, we are the applicant for this. Currently, the interpretation has been that RVs are classified under campgrounds. They're actually specifically mentioned within the campground definition, while manufactured homes are the only thing that is permitted within manufactured housing. So consequently, up until this point, the two are somewhat mutually exclusive and distinct from each other. Council on August 5th directed us to go ahead and begin to research and draft an amendment, which we are now bringing before you tonight, with the stipulations that RVs not be visible from the street and not change the essential character of the mobile home park as a place for manufactured homes. So within the ordinance, we are proposing that we add a regulatory section within that part of, I believe it's Chapter 2, that deals with mobile home parks, and this specific section would directly address what the limitations and expectations for RVs would be. So here we would add subsection 4, basically just documenting that we are acknowledging that RVs are not typically acceptable for long-term habitation, and that they are otherwise restricted to placement within campgrounds. But for temporary residents, such as military personnel, college students, and people who are on temporary business assignments in the area, that they could be located or locate their RVs within a mobile home park as long as the following conditions are met. The first one that we have proposed is to put a cap on the percentage of spaces within a mobile home park that could be devoted to RV use. There's just specific there about how we calculate. We've had some discussions, particularly with the Hargroves, and I think they'll be able to explain it a little better. From what I understand, currently they have about 20% vacancy in their mobile home park. There has been some discussions between them and myself about whether or not 15% or even 20% might be appropriate. With the discussion that took place at the Planning and Engineering Subcommittee, staff, we did express a concern that we weren't really sure that we wanted those small parks within our jurisdiction. We have several that are probably between 5 and 7 lots, and that's it, that those parks, that the percentage be high enough that they would be able to qualify for one spot. So we'll leave that, I think, question open to see if you all have any feedback on that. The type, any RV that would be located within the park would need to be self-sufficient. It would need to contain a full bathroom, kitchen, and sleeping quarters. Most of them do. I'm not aware of too many that wouldn't meet that requirement. The placement, we talked about either locating no closer than 300 feet to the right-of-way or if the owner is able to install a screen of a Type B buffer yard. In that case, then we would allow them to be located closer if they are screened appropriately. That screening can take place anywhere in the intervening footage. Next, we would be looking for utility hookups, that they must be connected to electric, water, and sewer for the entire duration of the stay. And speaking of that duration, initially we had proposed something along the lines of a month to a year with possible renewals. The idea came up about college students, and at least just kind of initially stating that that four-year term could be possible. Annual submittal of the register, again, just an administrative means of staff being able to track who is residing in those dedicated spaces. The register is already required of mobile home parks in subsection 6. This would just require them to go ahead and file it with us once a year following the 1st of January. In the following sections are just some minor edits, and then the following sections are also renumbered. Again, this was discussed at the October 14th meeting of the Planning and Engineering Subcommittee, and we were directed to go ahead and bring this forward to you. At the end of hearing any public testimony, we would ask that you close this public hearing and refer ZTA 613 to the LURB for their consideration next Tuesday.
Okay. Questions for staff?
How did you, could you repeat how you derived at the 10%?
The 10%, again, came from the desire not to change the character overall of the manufactured home district. We just feel that once that percentage starts to creep up, the character then starts to change. You get away from the predominating use being the mobile home, manufactured home placements, and it being more RVs. And again, with the smaller parks, that's much more obvious. And we didn't really want to draw a distinction between small parks and large parks. So therefore, we set it at 10% for now. But again, 15%, 20%. 20% is where, you know, we as staff think it starts to maybe get away from the manufactured home park.
That's what I was sitting here trying to figure numbers. Yeah. And, you know, I was at 15% to 18%. Mm-hmm. Would be a good figure, you know, knowing the ones that we got around here. Even though we got some smaller ones, that still allows them to have two or three possibly sites at that 15% to 18%. So we're not really doing anything against them. But it allows larger ones to have just a few more without changing the character of it and all that. So, I'm just
more,
you know,
inclined with the 15% to 18%.
Yeah,
well.
That's what I just by numbers is what I was looking at.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions for staff? I do have one suggestion on the language, whatever the percentage is, under A. It says only 10%. I think I would say no more than, just to make it clear that we're not designating 10%, that it's no more than 10%. So it can be up to whatever the number we say it is, but it doesn't have to be that number.
Okay. So it'd be no more than whatever percentage it came up to.
Right. Any other questions or comments for staff?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right. This is
the Land Use Review Board's going to look at it anyway, so yeah. We can just let them know that's a topic of discussion.
Right. Yeah, that's
all right. This is a public hearing. I know we have some people who are interested tonight. I don't know if y'all want to speak on this item, Hargroves, but if anybody would like to speak on this item, please step up, state your name and address, and let us hear what you have to say on this. Okay. All right, then what I would suggest, are there any more questions from council? If not, I say we kick this to the LURB to have a discussion with specific attention being what is the appropriate percentage that we think makes sense for this. And I appreciate Jeff's comments because we have, with the Hargroves, a very responsible group of folks that manage their community well. And what we want to do is make sure we give them options to succeed in their business, but do not allow others who might not do such a wonderful job to do things that would be inappropriate. So with that, if there's no further discussion, can we get a motion?
I'd like to make a motion to close the public hearing and refer ZTA-6-13 to the November 12th, 2013 Land Use Review Board meeting.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Motion carries as well. All right, lighting ordinance amendment. Getting a workout tonight, aren't you, Mr. Triesenberg?
Yeah. It's been a busy few weeks, that's for sure. This one has been a little bit more of a long-term project that we've been researching and learning more about over the probably since January when we finished the UDO or comprehensive plan, no, UDO update. I'm getting my two mixed up. But this is coming to you from us as the land use administrator. When we finished the UDO update process back in January, we knew that we had this chapter still outstanding. We had hoped that a new model lighting ordinance that was put out by the International Dark Sky Association and the Illuminating Engineering Society, they collaborated on this new supposed great model ordinance. But the more we looked at it, the more we realized it probably needs some tweaking, needs some work.
They call themselves the Dark Knights.
The Dark Knights, there you go. But we did meet with planning and engineering on this back in the spring of this year. And we threw out a bunch of different objectives and goals that we hope to achieve with a rewrite. And you see those listed here. Most importantly, trying to get some new standards in there for LED lighting. And then just basically meeting our other goals and objectives that we had been with the rewrites of the previous chapters. So again, as I said, there is a new model lighting ordinance that's out there. This was the only chapter left in the original format. The LED lighting introduces a new rating system for light fixtures called the BUG rating system. BUG stands for backlight, uplight, and glare. So each new fixture that comes out these days now has an associated BUG rating. It used to be that they were cutoff ratings, so you had cutoff, semi-cutoff, full cutoff, but that is now no longer the case. So again, LED options and technologies, they've been increasing and improving at a very rapid rate, and they have different fundamentals in how they produce the light, how they deliver the light. So we kind of we're kind of bridging the gap right now, I think, in terms of trying to introduce some LED standards, but keeping our existing standards for traditional fixtures as well.
You're talking about shield? We're going to shield LED just like we do neon and all that stuff. And is that what you're, or are you going to allow LED to be exterior?
LED can now, under this proposal, be exterior lighting. In fact, it's actually more of a preferred method of exterior lighting. When we will still keep the shielding requirements for when it's used as building accent lighting, but for just general outdoor pole fixtures, LED is actually the preferred method now because it delivers all of its light much more efficiently, and it's a pointed light delivery source as opposed to a reflected and refracted delivery.
Okay. That's the only thing.
So we did do a complete rewrite. You're not seeing any edits in this presentation to you. It's just completely brand new language. Many of the core requirements have been retained, but nearly everything has been touched up and cleaned up. So the purpose and intent, it was rewritten to emphasize correction of poor lighting practices, preserving safety and security measures. I think we were able to lump some of the security lighting features together much more effectively than before. A goal of improving nighttime visibility, as well as encouraging more efficient use of energy. So in 11.2 is now the applicability section. For now, it just remains applicable to new development. Chapter 13, which is our nonconformities chapter, deals with existing development. So we may want to discuss that at some time in the future as to where that might fit in with our change of use perspective and how far and when we would want to trigger lighting upgrades. We do have also a list of exemptions within this section, and it was expanded a little bit from the current list. Some things just weren't previously mentioned that we wanted to go ahead and explicitly say that they were exempt, including gas lamps and low voltage landscape lighting. Section 11.3 is now brings up a little more front and center the types of lighting that are prohibited. Again, it's pretty much an existing list that was already in the ordinance, but we did add items D and E, which is excessively bright light strings. If you've been to something like a, I'm trying to think who has these, Macaroni Grill maybe, some of the Italian restaurants around the exterior. If those were extremely bright lights, that could be contribute to a high amount of glare.
I mean, Councilman Tripp cannot do his Griswold Christmas display this year.
Seasonal lighting will still be exempt.
I already know right now.
Griswold's with good taste.
That string light's not bad.
We also added any lights that may be confused with traffic control devices. Sometimes folks can get something that looks very similar to traffic lights. We don't want them putting those up in their yard. But otherwise, that section was largely the same. Then we grouped a bunch of standards into a general section, much like we do with most of the other chapters. Sections A and B pretty much are carried over from the old ordinance, but Section C introduces standards for LED lighting. Two things about it that seem to be most prominent that folks are interested in regulating. One is the color rendition index. That gets at the nighttime visibility. Generally, what I found is that if a fixture at least has a index of 70, that means that the color that you see will actually appear to be much more true to life and contribute to better visibility. A standard high-pressure sodium fixture, which is mostly what we have in Knightdale today, only has a CRI of between 20 and 30. Again, high-pressure sodium at the time was a good move forward because it saved on energy and it lasted longer. But as I'm sure you know, almost everything appears brown. Trying to get back, I think, more to what it looked like before when mercury vapor lights and such were more the norm. And the second is color temperature, making sure that the white light is not harsh and very glare-inducing to the human eye. So typically, we want to see a color temperature of about 4,200 or so or less. Sections D, E, and F, again, are from the current ordinance. And then Section G is added to address situations where we have adjacent parcels that have a pretty significant difference in elevation. particularly on mass graded sites. This can become an issue. And these are proposed as some best practices that we observed from other municipal ordinances. So currently, if both properties, I have a dashed line down the center kind of representing the property line. If they were both at the same elevation, you can see that the light fixture would hit about halfway up the building that's on the adjacent property. However, if there's a difference in topography between the two, you can see very quickly that the amount of light being cast onto the adjacent property can increase quickly. So therefore, we want to be able to have some kind of ability to go back to the developer of the property with the lighting and say, you need to add shielding to keep this light from going on to the neighboring property and impacting them negatively. Then in 11.5A, this is the section that begins with our specific standards for various lighting types. 11.5A is our street light standards. Again, the big change here is that we would like to see the requirement of LED lighting. It's much more easy to control. There's much less glare, much less backlight. The visibility improves. There's just so many things about it that are more efficient, saves the town money, and delivers a better product. It improves the spacing to correlate with density and street classifications. The regulations also look at minimum lighting levels. And there we had to kind of, that's the difficult part in that traditional fixtures, when you see a lumen level, it's lumens measured at the bulb. But LED lights are not calculated that way. They're actually calculated in the lumens that are delivered at the surface. Traditional lights, they lose a lot of lumens before it actually gets to the ground. So that's why you will see a lower lumen level count for LED lights as opposed to traditional fixtures. It adds maximum bug ratings, again, getting at how much backlight, uplight, and glare is permissible for each type. And then there's stronger wording regarding placement. One thing that we've noticed is that sometimes we don't get a fixture at an intersection quite where we would like it to be. So we've tried to emphasize some of those things a little more as well. Post-top lights, we wanted to better emphasize that we don't generally permit those as street lights. So we tried to emphasize again the focus areas as being pedestrian walkways outside of the right-of-way, as well as wide sidewalks in our commercial and mixed-use areas if somebody chooses to develop in that manner. The height standard remains the same. But again, we do introduce those new LED standards in the form of bug ratings and things like that.
Are we going to change the foot, the height, we would the still, LED versus the other?
We would still do 18.
Still do 18, no matter what. Okay.
Then section C, subsection C, would be for accent lighting. Again, most of this carries over from the old ordinance. We do add a vertical standard, again, for property line measurements to make sure that there's not too much light spilling over into neighboring properties. And we do also add an express permission for residential light posts, which was never in there before. And you see an example of one of those if you're wondering what a residential light post is. Subsection D is probably the one that we use most, and that's for parking and area lighting. It does maintain the requirement for forward throw fixtures at the property edges. It concentrates most of the light in a forward manner into the parking lot as opposed to projecting it to the sides where it's more apt to spill over onto a neighboring property. Again, adopting bug ratings for the LED fixtures that we would like to see more of. And then also introducing dimming requirements for after hours. A lot of light can be is unnecessarily put out there when parcels aren't being used, but it does maintain the Illuminating Engineering Society's recommendation for what minimum amounts of levels should be available 24 hours for safety and security purposes. It doesn't dictate a method by which that would happen, so folks would be able to choose from either manual methods or some type of electronic automated device. Subsection E then again groups some different categories of lighting that we had previously into one section called security lighting. This includes the power company supplied dusk to dawn lights that people may have installed in their backyard. It also includes wall packs that people would use at entrances to buildings, as well as flood and spotlights. So here we would emphasize lower but very focused light output. And the dawn to dusk regulations, again, are taken kind of as a best practice from other municipalities that have adopted regulations in their ordinance, and very typical to what we have for streetlights. Subsection F deals with gas stations specifically in the canopies. That was simply carried over from the current ordinance. And then 11.6, we have our lighting level section, which again, the tables that exist within that section are found currently in our ordinance. We did add the provisions for after hours, as well as lowering some of the residential requirements that they're not quite as bright, but still in keeping with the Engineering Society's recommended levels. We found that we were actually a little bit high on that. And then finally, Section 7 deals with the measurement. Again, that just deals with what the planning department would use to actually measure the lighting and carry forward the standards for such equipment. This was originally discussed again at the P&E committee meeting back in April. They directed staff to bring forward eventually the proposal for the new ordinance with those six objectives and goals as our primary focus. Again, we would ask that after the public hearing here tonight that you go ahead and close it and refer this to the LURB for comment next Tuesday. And if you have any questions, I'll do my best to get you an answer.
Can you go back to the first and kind of go over it again?
That's
all right. All I will tell you, Jeff, is it's times like this that we appreciate experienced staff.
Yes.
Because if left up to the council, the bugs would not be the only.
I was wondering when it said the bug thing, I was wondering, is that number of bugs per light? You know, so, okay.
Crickets chirping.
How fast they attract
them?
Yeah,
have to get there.
All right. So, any questions about that? And if not, I think we would like a motion to refer. Wait, this is a public hearing first. In case there is somebody here who would like to comment on the lighting ordinance amendment. Nobody. All right, staff did a wonderful job with that. So if there is no one here that would like to comment on that amendment, then can we get a motion to close this and refer it to the LURB? Is that correct?
That's correct.
Yes, sir.
All right.
I'll make a motion to close the public hearing and refer zoning text amendment 9-13 to the November 2nd, 2013 Land Use Review Board meeting.
Second.
Have a motion second. All in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? All right. Comprehensive plan amendment.
And much like the development ordinance had one chapter remaining, we also had the comprehensive plan left with one chapter remaining. The chapter in the comprehensive plan that was left out of the update process was chapter 3. That was the one that was very data intensive and actually gave the original writing of the comprehensive plan its push and its drive to get to the recommendations that were eventually put forward. So again, just to recap, back on April 6th of 2009, the council adopted the resolution that established the Comprehensive Plan Update Committee. And over the next year and a half, year and 9 months, the committee worked hard, and finally in January 19 of 11, the council adopted those updates. But Chapter 3 was not updated. We did not have new data from the Census Bureau yet at that point. All of the long-form data was moved into the American Community Survey, and we had to wait for 5 years of the American Community Survey to go through before we actually got a delivered data product. So it actually wasn't until, I think, late 2011, early 2012, that we finally had some updated data to begin looking at. So we have examined all of the data components that existed in Chapter 3. They were largely grouped into 8 areas. You see those listed here. The first 4, geography, population, demographics, housing, were pretty easy to update and compare due to the availability of the census data. But the next 4 were a little more difficult. In particular, commercial real estate data is very difficult for us to get at. A lot of that is proprietary sources that we would need to get that data from. The zoning comparison was largely a moot point because we have brand new districts, and we moved from a more of a reactive method to a proactive method. Land use and values I'd hoped would be a little easier, but changes to the Wake County Tax Assessor's Office data made that somewhat difficult. And then we were able to get a little bit at the economic character section as well. But just to highlight the major findings of what we went through, the area in the town limits in ETJ has doubled since the 2002 version of the comp plan was done. We now have annexation agreement lines on all sides, and there also is no more long-range urban service area. We only have short-range. So quite a few significant changes, I would say, in terms of the geography and area of Knightdale. In terms of population growth, we updated that chart showing our growth since 1960. The last decade, even though it was a smaller percentage growth, it was still the largest numerical growth that the town exhibited. In terms of density, the corporate limit density went down slightly from 3.39 people per acre to 2.81. I have a feeling that most of this was attributable to all the annexations we did and the fact that those areas are still not completely built out. Also, we had probably our largest spurt of commercial growth in the last decade as well. But as you can see, the entire planning area density was up. It went from 0.79 people per acre to 1.25. In terms of demographics, some of the major findings there, we are still a relatively young population, but we are beginning to trend a little bit older. You see it at the extremes in terms of the age groups of small infants and toddlers is down, but the number of folks over 65 is increasing as a percentage. But everything in between from 5 to 64 is pretty much the same percentage-wise. Also, race and ethnicity makeup. This was probably the most significant demographic change. In 1990, Knightdale was 90% Caucasian and 10% was all the other groups combined. Today in 2010, we're 50-50. All races and ethnicities, though, as you can see from the chart above, are growing. Looking at education levels, they have been increasing as the population has grown, particularly, again, in the last decade. Nearly 50% of Knightdale residents now have a degree of some sort. And again, most of that change has occurred since 2000. 1990 to 2000, there really wasn't much of a shift. In terms of housing, our housing values are up. But there's still more housing at lower price points than the county average. And when we look at owner-occupied versus renter-occupied, we have seen our share of renter-occupied housing increasing. Again, I would say that's largely attributable to the new apartment complexes in town. I don't think as much of that is due to housing, single-family housing, changing from owner to renter. The number of single-family detached dwellings by size. Housing unit size has increased significantly, and actually a number of our smallest units have either been torn down or converted to some other kind of use. But there you can see now that rather than 1,000 to 1,500 square foot homes being the largest makeup of Knightdale housing, it's now 1,500 to 2,000, with 2,000 to 2,500 square feet not far behind. Commercial real estate, again, as I noted before, we do have limited access to good data sources here. But what I was able to put together, either from county assessor's data or the economic census, indicates that the town actually fares well in most of the categories when we compare our share of the population to Wake County. Our population is about 1.3%, but as you can see, retail, industrial, and apartments do exceed that. So we're probably doing pretty well, I think, in terms of contributing our share and getting our share of those kinds of businesses. Zoning, again, is difficult to compare because of the different categories and the way we go about it. So I'm not going to spend any time on that. Land use and values, again, the tax office data, they used to use 16 different use categories. Now they use more than 40. That was very difficult to even begin to try and compare those, let alone the number of properties now that have multiple cards. We have a lot of more commercial properties where there's more than one building on a parcel. And so it's very, even with GIS, it's very difficult to extract that back out. But you can see that about 50% of our corporate limit value is in residential development. And the economic character, again, this was limited largely to census population data. So again, it was about where the person worked, what business they were employed in. The economic census data is coming out, I think, in the next year. The most recent is 2007. And the other thing that's available is zip code data, but that doesn't match up very well with our corporate limits. But you can see there that, to me, the most important finding there was the same finding they made when they wrote the plan in 2002, is that our economic character and prosperity is very much tied with the larger Raleigh-Cary MSA, and in fact, the data is almost identical. So as the Raleigh-Cary MSA goes, so does Knightdale. Just some summary thoughts from the staff. We do believe that Knightdale is statistically different from 2002. We believe that the impetus for the previous plan was really the upcoming major infrastructure projects. We had the two big road projects and a bunch of sewer and water projects. And so now our feelings are that a new plan should be undertaken. I think we have in the long-range plan in fiscal year 15, hopefully to get a new comprehensive planning process started that would now shift from anticipating infrastructure improvements to actually focusing on the optimal utilization of those assets, protecting what resources we do have, and promoting quality development that will sustain itself due to our defined borders and limited land resources. So again, here we would recommend that you hear from anyone on this, close the public hearing, and refer this to the LURB for comment.
Okay. And I will say, I mean, the demographic data, if you haven't gone through and read that, you should go through and read that. It's very interesting to go see how things have changed and where we are as a community. It was a comprehensive demographic update, so thank you for that. This is a public hearing. Is there anyone here tonight that would like to comment on this item? Seeing no one. Any further discussion among the council? If not, can we get a motion?
Make a motion to close the public hearing and refer the comprehensive plan to the Land Use Review Board meeting.
Second.
Motion second. Any further discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Okay, no public hearings to set. Mr. Holt, do you have anything for us tonight?
No, sir, I do not.
All right, old business. Knightdale Investors, Ordinance 1311-4002.
All right, now I can see the light at the end of the tunnel.
That's because we're getting a lighting thing.
Bugs is that light.
More bug moths, number. Two lightning bugs.
All right, so I had three new ones for you tonight, and I have three coming back. The first is ZMA 113. This is the map amendment for Knightdale Investors. Again, with these, I'm not going to spend much time on them, but just to summarize, again, for those folks viewing on TV or in the audience, this is the location and request related to the Knightdale Station residential development. Again, asking for some shifting of the boundary lines, as well as introducing a pretty significant chunk of open space preservation area. Again, we did talk about the new permissible uses that would be introduced by this rezoning. Nothing that seems too objectionable. The one thing that we did see was the introduction of cemeteries. At the LURB meeting, Mr. Robbie Oldham was present to answer any questions on behalf of the applicant. There weren't any, and it was a fairly straightforward meeting. Again, just a reminder of the statutory responsibilities for both boards and the proposed written advisory statement that I will read into the record for you. The proposed zoning map amendment is reasonable in that it supports the stated objective of creating a supporting community image and identity that local businesses and or development may tap into and partner in through the extension of the OSP zoning district, which houses the new public community park. It is furthermore consistent with the comprehensive plan's stated goal of providing dynamic and sustainable neighborhoods, which offer adequate shelter and recreational amenities. If you agree with that, we would recommend that you adopt that statement of plan consistency and reasonableness of action, approve ZMA 113, and adopt it as ordinance number 2 for tonight.
All right. Any questions? Nope, we've seen this before. All right. There's no questions or further discussions. Can we get a motion, please?
I'll make a motion to adopt statement of plan consistency and reasonableness of action and approve zoning map amendment 1-13 and adopt ordinance number 13-11-04-002.
Second.
I have a motion and second. Any further discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. All right, you're in the short rows now, Mr. Triesenberg, to Suburban Chickens.
Yes, number 2, ZTA 713, our Suburban Chickens tonight, no clip art. Again, this was the application requesting a text amendment to section 4.6 for accessory buildings. And again, we had the previous town code amendment that you approved tonight, which was ordinance number 1. Again, it is a big topic these days. It may be a passing fad. We really don't know. But for those who are interested in doing it, they tend to be very focused and serious about wanting to be able to do it and do it in a responsible manner. So again, part of the growing local foods movement, in harmony with statewide efforts, and we also believe it would fit with the council's efforts to make us a more green community. We did also take a look at how chickens need to be cared for, and we did put forth a lot of our regulations based on responsible backyard farming, addressing potential noise, odor, pest, public health, and safety for the flock. Apart from a few questions of clarification, the LURB did not propose any substantive changes. What you do see is going to be highlighted in red. What I've started doing is actually taking the existing, what you saw first, and putting it in blue so that you can actually pick out the changes more apparently. We did change the chicken coop standard for and move from a maximum height to the maximum size that we talked about at the public hearing. Again, this will also keep it under the threshold requiring a building permit. And the LURB also talked about the commercial sale, and we proposed, just to make that a little more general, I don't think anybody's going to be up in arms if a local child decides to take a few to the farmer's market to sell. But the object here is that they not be selling them from the house. Again, a reminder of the statutory responsibilities for both boards, which leads us to this statement of plan consistency and reasonableness of action. That the proposed zoning text changes are reasonable and that they provide specific regulatory language that allows for a more rural activity in a suburban backyard environment while safeguarding against potential violations of the town's nuisance ordinances. The proposed changes are also consistent with the comprehensive plan's stated goal of maintaining a respect for the existing relationship between rural and urban Knightdale by permitting a residential accessory use associated with the traditional family farm, which was the predominant land use at the time of Knightdale's incorporation. Again, if you agree with that statement, we would recommend that you adopt that as the council's official statement of plan consistency and reasonableness of action. Approve ZTA 713 and adopt ordinance number 3 for tonight.
All right. This should wrap up our chickens.
Yeah.
Any comments or questions? I know this went to P&E and they were good with it. We wanted the restriction on the overall size, mm-hmm. and we got that. That was my only question last time, so I'm good with it. Mm-hmm. Any other questions or comments?
I'm reading the ordinance. Are the coops movable? Can they move around the yard?
You could move them. Theoretically.
Because I've had a couple people call me and say, hey, you know, we could fertilize the mm-hmm. yard by movable coops.
Right. It it does not allow for what folks would, from what I understand.
I got to hang out with your friends, man. I'm clearly with the wrong crowd.
What's the percentage of nitrogen you're putting out?
See that? Is your question? So it doesn't allow for chicken tractors, which is basically the movable run. But theoretically, the hen house with the run attached to it would be movable. They would just have to show us within their site plan that they wouldn't move it outside the
setbacks. Have this little chicken coop on wheels, push it around the yard now. It'll lock down the wheels and move it to the next location. Oh my goodness.
Alright, I just want to make sure they were movable within the yard.
Oh my goodness.
Alright.
Thank you, Jeff.
You're welcome.
Any other questions besides Councilor Edens for
I
staff?
I hope not.
Alright. Can we get a motion, thankfully?
Make a motion to adopt statement of plan consistency and reasonableness of action to approve ZTA 713 and adopt ordinance 1311-04003.
Second.
We have a motion and a second.
Chickens.
Any further discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? That motion carries. All right. Two more. Board of Adjustment Amendments.
ZTA 813 is also coming back to you tonight. Again, this was dealing with the changes due to the recent changes in state law regarding how the Board of Adjustment operates. We did feel that it was significant enough of a change that we should go ahead and rewrite it. Certainly not that we would advocate rewriting every time something small changes, but we did feel that this was enough to justify a change. So again, this stems from House Bill 276, which was signed into law on June 19th. After the LURB meeting and talking again with Mr. York, we did make a couple small changes. The LURB does tend to look to the relevant sections of the ordinance as kind of their guide for conducting the hearings, I think, so it is somewhat helpful for them to have it within their ordinance books. And one thing that they were having a little difficulty with was making the connection to subsection 4, where the findings of fact are located. So there was just a recommendation there that we add a reference to that section that would kind of serve as an indicator for them to look down the ordinance and find those and make sure that they understood that the findings of fact still need to be made before they can actually grant a variance. But other than that, everything else largely stayed the same. We do have provisions elsewhere in the ordinance that cover us when those minor changes are made in state law that reference that state law always supersedes. So at the LURB meeting, there was no one there to speak on this one. So this one again moved forward once we got past the discussion about the findings of fact. So again, we have a brief statement of plan consistency and reasonableness of action that although the proposed changes do not expressly advance any of the specific goals of the comprehensive plan, the proposed zoning text changes are reasonable and that they reflect the current status of state law in regard to the matters at hand. Again, we would ask that if you agree with that, to adopt the statement of plan consistency and reasonableness of action, approve ZTA 813, and adopt ordinance number 4 tonight.
Sorry, this one just back to the lovely legislative session we had. Any questions on something we don't have a choice with? All right. In that case, we'll entertain a motion.
I'll make the motion to adopt statement plan consistency and reasonableness of action to approve ZTA-8-13 and adopt ordinance number 13-11-04-004.
Second.
I have a motion and second. Any further discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Motion carries. All right. Last but not least, the Knightdale Park Phase 1 Settlement Agreement.
Good evening, Mayor, members of Town Council. Bring before you this evening the proposed settlement agreement for Knightdale Park Phase 1. During the course of the construction, we were presented with two claims filed by PLT in the removal and reinstallation of some sidewalk along Griffin Street, which is now Wilder Nursery Trail, and the installation of some concrete footers for the bicycle racks outside of restroom 2. We also had a few outstanding change orders that should have been processed along the way, but due to the shift in their project management, didn't get processed timely enough, but we needed to go ahead and close those out. Those are credit for work descoped from the project. Outstanding change orders, such as the ones documented in the agreement, the sanitary sewer, 6-inch sanitary sewer upgrade that we did, and then we also had the outstanding item of the assessment of the liquidated damages since the project was past its scheduled delivery date. All of those are presented in the settlement agreement as we're basically calling everything a all even and a wash. Additionally, we have attached a few of the deferred items that were just not seasonally appropriate to finish out. That's the sod maintenance and grow-in period for the four athletic fields, the installation of the warm season long grass, which is currently, we have cool season grass just for turf coverage, and the installation of all of the deferred plantings that just were not appropriate to plant in July. And that attachment in Exhibit C describes the responsibilities and delivery for all of those items.
All right. Any questions for Mr. Boone? I will say that I talked with Seth and Fred when this was going on, and I think all things considered, this is a good deal for us to finish this, move them out, and move on to phase two. It was a good way to bring it to a relatively successful close for everybody, and park is packed every time we go by there, and that's what's really important.
Are they? Are we still holding retainage, just in case they do not complete these?
Yes, we're holding over $250,000 in retainage, and that's by our estimation more than enough to cover the outstanding deferred items. PLT has agreed that they will not draw that down until everything is complete. So we're holding it till it's done.
Excellent.
Okay. PLT was pretty reasonable in working a deal on this. Okay. Any other questions for Mr. Boone? All right. Thank you, Fred.
Thank you.
I think this is a good deal that makes sense. We'll close up phase one and continue on to phase two, except for the outstanding things that I'm sure the Mayor Pro Tem will continue to monitor them on.
You can believe that.
While we pay him the big bucks.
Mm-hmm.
All right. In that case, can we get a motion?
I'll make the motion to approve the settlement agreement and authorize the town manager to forward it to PLT.
Second.
I have a motion and a second to approve the settlement agreement, authorize town manager to sign it and forward it. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you.
Thank you. And new business, property donation offer. Last big item on there.
Good evening, Mayor, members of the council. Hope you all are doing well tonight. I want to say what a great job Jeff did to get through all that stuff in about an hour. That's amazing. But
Fischenberg is highly efficient in working through dense materials.
Indeed. Maybe in people too. So, but wanted to bring this item to your attention this evening. We've been working with the developers of the Princeton Manor subdivision, Southern Developers. They have offered to the town the dedication of approximately 40 acres of land that are environmentally sensitive lands, but they are adjacent to the Neuse River and Mingo Creek. So we do feel like there is some benefit to the town owning that property. Certainly it's a benefit to the current owners as well, as they do get a tax benefit from this dedication. But we have reached a point with them where before we move forward, we need to spend a little bit of money, and they want to get a sense of how council feels about this dedication before they make that expenditure. So with that being said, I'll go over the parcels real quick. This parcel right here already exists, a little over 10 acres. This is the phase that's getting ready to be recorded next right here in this area. It is adjacent to the Neuse River, does have some environmental features on it that will need to be considered as far as any future development, greenway, et cetera, in the future, but it would be dedicated to the town. This is a parcel that would need to be subdivided because it's part of a future phase. Right now, it's actually all of this constitutes this parcel. That's one of the items they'd have to move forward with an expenditure now on. And then finally, this parcel right here, which is a landlocked parcel, but adjacent to Mingo Creek. This is the VFW building, just to give you a sense of what we're looking at there. And in the past, one of the things we had considered there is the possibility of that maybe being a trailhead for our greenway.
Exactly what I was going to ask for an access point.
Which, you know, we would still have to evaluate the suitability of that, but that's something that we could do with that parcel, even though it's landlocked. We had discussions with the VFW folks some years ago about the possibility of accessing over their site to reach that parcel. So we'd have to bring that back up, and no promises there, but that's something that we could do with those parcels. We have talked about this with the town attorney. They had a few comments for us. That's what the developer's working on right now. There was a phase one environmental assessment done with this for these parcels a few years ago. We will be reviewing that in the coming days, but we wanted to stop before we got too far down the road, make sure council was agreeable to the concept. And if you are, we will hammer out the details and then bring it to council for final approval, probably either at the second meeting in November or the first meeting in December. Be happy to take any questions you might have.
No, I think this makes sense and presents us some opportunities going forward for a Neuse River park-like feature that we've Yeah, we've talked about and talked to other landowners about something.
From this point north, we've got quite a bit already of OSP-zoned land that would be very suitable for some type of public amenity on the river there.
So I think it makes lots of sense for that reason, as long as we can get through the due diligence and make sure we're not inheriting something we don't want. Any other thoughts or comments? All right. If not, can we get a motion to authorize the town manager to proceed with accepting this land donation and the due diligence that goes with it?
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
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 All right. All right. Any other business? Other than reminding everybody to vote tomorrow, town council elections are tomorrow. Any committee reports?
Public safety did not meet tonight, Mr. Mayor. We simply postponed our meeting until the third Wednesday of the month, which I think is going to be the 20th, November 20th, if I'm not mistaken.
Okay.
I'd just like to remind everybody that Planning and Engineering Committee will meet on November 12th, which is a Tuesday, not our normal Monday because of Veterans Day. The only other thing I'd like to say, I'd like to thank staff and the police department for all the help with Heather's Dance, Dance for Hope 5K run this weekend, this past Saturday. It was a good event, and nice to see the town support a local 5K.
Good. All right. Any other committee reports? Any reason to go into closed session?
Yes, sir.
Can I get a motion to adjourn?
Make a motion to adjourn.
Second.
Second.
Motion second. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries. We're adjourned. Thank you.